sober. Be vigilant. Because your adversary, and he tells you who he is, he says, your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion. Somebody say, like a roaring lion. Seeking whom he may devour. He's seeking, he's looking for somebody to kill. And that's what's going on here. If they had the fires burning, the wild animals, the lion would have stayed clear of the camp. But when the fires went out, he came in and he attacked. Paul, I'm not going to stay long today, but I just come with this little package today. In 2 Timothy, I want you to watch what he says. He says to young Timothy, he says, Timothy, I remember the genuine faith that you have, your genuine faith, it's powerful. He says, for you share the faith that filled your grandmother Lewis. Talking about the same faith. How many's got a grandmother that's praying for you? How many have one that's been praying for you? See, that same faith is sustaining you today, isn't it? And he says, and the faith of your mother, Eunice. And he says, I know that same faith is in you and continues in you and to strengthen you, make you strong. He says, this is why I remind you to fan into flame, to stir up the gift, fan into flame, keep alive the flame in your life, the gift of God, that I have laid hands on you. And he continues a little bit and he says, for God has not given us, Timothy, the spirit of fear and of timidity. But what he did give us is what, help me with this, power, love, and a sound mind or self-discipline. That's what God has given us. So we have tools. We have what it takes to keep the fire burning. We have what it will require. How many know there's some things that will require that's needed in a natural flame? Oh, Brother Howard, the other day, he made sure we had fire on the outside. And I noticed on the back of his truck, he had plenty supply of wood. I mean, he stacked it up. It was ready to go. And he had enough on the fire. And perhaps maybe when he started, he had to fan that thing, had to blow. For it to ignite. The time we got there, how many noticed there was a beautiful fire that morning that was burning? But just in case that the fire would go out or something would happen, he had enough supply to feed the fire. How's your life this morning? Do you have enough on the inside? Do you have enough word? Do you have enough scripture? How many know as you get into the word of God, that's fuel for your fire? You want fuel for the fire? Get into the word of God. There's no bypass to doing this. And especially when you find your wood's a little wet. How many's had your wood wet a little bit? And Lord, the preacher would preach and this would happen and that, and you don't feel anything. That's the time you better be, oh my goodness, Lord, put a fire on in my soul. Don't be satisfied and say, well, I had enough, that's okay. No, that's a red flag right there. What tools, what ammunition, what wood, what do you have to continue this flame? You know, because God said to Moses, you got to make sure, tell the priest, this fire cannot go out. It has to continually be burning day and night. How many know that means you couldn't have all the priesthood go fall asleep? Somebody had to stoke the fire through the midnight hours. There's some people in our church that thank God for another piece of wood that they put on there. It's people who know how to pray, how to touch God in the midnight hour. What are they doing? They're fanning the flame. They're putting more wood on that fire and it'll keep burning. Some turn around and say, oh, I just feel, I'm tired. I don't want to. Brother, don't let the fire go out. Don't get so complacent in your walk with God. Don't get so acquainted with the things of God. You know, there's sometimes when we just get too acquainted. Somebody asked me some time back, do you still get nervous when you get up on a platform? Maybe you can't tell it, but sure, on the inside, my butterflies are having butterflies, I'm telling you. I mean, we all can't. Don't ever become too comfortable. Don't ever do you see a miracle. Oh, that was nice.
Right.
How's the passion in your life? How's your worship? I'm talking about what will fuel the flame in your life. Well, I didn't sing my song, so I'm not going to lift my hands and praise the Lord. Really, it's your song and it's the one you like. How about the song he likes to hear? Well, I don't like that style. Well, how about the style he likes to hear? You can go from one continent to another. How many know God enjoys all kinds of styles of music? As long as it's from the heart and it's true worship. I'll take you to a tribe in Africa. They're the tallest ones there. But you know the way they dance is straight up. Boy, and every one of them is 6'10" or more. And these people want to get taller. And so they jump straight up. The Maasai tribe. And you and I want to go there. Well, you can't do that. He'll throw a spear at you. Don't tell him what he can't do. That's his worship unto the living God. And you go down south in the Zulu tribe. See, I've traveled throughout just about every one of them. Traveled into Zulus, and I could dance with the best of them. They probably laugh when I try. But the Zulu dance, all these warriors, they're going to go, boy, you better not be under their foot because they're going to crush you. And you know how they come up and dance. That's part of their dance. That's part of their worship when they come and got saved. Don't tell them, Zulu, how you can dance. You call Shaka on you. You know who Shaka? I'll have to give you a history lesson. You go down to some of the Indian tribes here in the U.S. They may dance, you know, when they get saved. They may still want to dance. And you know what? Come on. Preaching better than some of you shouting right now. Come on, somebody lift up a shout. You just gave an extra piece of wood on the fire. He said, shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. And he wasn't, no, that's not upset, you know, the other guys. He said, shout. That means that's my fuel for my fire. I believe when I lift up holy hands and I shout, demons start running because I'm lifting up the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 I don't feel like lifting my hands. I believe your hands are like radar antennas that will go up. And when you worship the Lord, I believe mighty things happen in the spiritual realm. Things that the devil had planned for your life just because you worship, just because you Deuteronomy says, because you did not worship the Lord with gladness of heart. Deuteronomy, God said to them, here's the reason why you are, many of you are sick. Here's the reason why many of you are under the pressure. Many of you are, he says, because you didn't worship the Lord with gladness of heart. Read it. He said, then the enemy would take over in your life. So I've decided a long time ago, man, I wasn't born just yesterday or out of from a turkey or something. I want to learn from my mistakes, you know. If I find out he says, worship me with all your heart, with all your might, Lord, I'm going to try to do it. Because there's blessing in it. Are you kidding me? Nature or no nature, I'm going to tell my nature, you get with the program, nature. Well, I wasn't raised like, well, raising, get with the program, get with why God likes it. You know, we want to do service the way we think it ought to be. Put it in a box. Pretty. Put a bow on it. Well, this is how God should like it. Now, why don't you find out what he likes and you change to suit what he likes? I really am trying to preach a good message. Pretty wonderful. I don't mean to upset people. That's not good. So I'm just going to blame it on the word. Amen. So he says, boys, here's what you got to do, young Timothy. Your mama laid hands on you. Your grandmother had faith. I'm laying hands on you. It's that same faith. It's that same fire, that same passion. Fan it into flame. keep it alive. When you leave the doors of this church, you know how we feel in here in our worship? Hey, he says, when you drive down the street, do the same thing. Keep it alive. Don't let the fire go out. When you're among friends, when you're among relatives, keep the fire going. Why are you going to change for them? You're not a chameleon.
Amen.
I'm going to hang out with my boys, with my friends, and I'm going to do what my friend, what are you? Change every, you know, come on. Stay constant. Stay who you are. Stay full of grace.
Jesus.
If they're hateful, that means you have to be.
Amen.
Oh, hallelujah.
Amen.
If they spit at you, well, just say you missed a spot. Here's another. That's tough. That's hard. That's not easy. Oh, hallelujah. This gospel is a good gospel. Oh, it's a wonderful gospel. Fan into flame the gift of God in your life. Beloved, that's what I'm driving home today. That beautiful gift that God has given each one of us. Don't let it die. Don't let the flame go out. Don't let life snuff out the flame. God says, he says to us, the Lord gave me a song some time ago. A broken reed will he not break. Smoking flax will he not quench. Listen, if there's a little flame, if there's just a little bit there, God will come in your life like he's doing this morning and go. What is he doing? He's trying to get some fire under that thing. Some wind. Let his wind come into your life this morning. Would you let him do that? Would you allow the Lord to touch you? Oh, I'm telling you, when we yield like that, when we allow God to bring back that first love, that passion, you're going to see some things that you've been praying for.
Yes.
Suddenly,
yes.
It happens.
Yes.
Some areas that was bound up, suddenly it's been released.
On,
you know, there may be some money in the bank that won't release or some whatever. Suddenly something's going to happen. You've been praying about a problem in your life or a sickness or whatever. Suddenly you're going to find, my goodness, pain's gone. What happened? You kept the fire alive in your life. You didn't get bitter. You didn't get critical. You didn't allow yourself to start, you know, blasting everybody. You kept a pure spirit. You kept a loving heart.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
I was sharing with somebody yesterday. We were sitting down. We were talking about a situation. And I said, no, here's what I believe. Even when they come at you from different directions, yeah, they may have hurt you, whatever. Don't go down to their level. Come up a little higher to where God is working with you. Keep loving them. Keep trying. Reaching out. Yeah, but I'm tired of reaching out. I'm tired of it. No. Do not get weary in well doing. Just when you keep on doing well, in due season, God in you. Fan into flame the passion of God in you. God has put something so valuable in you. Get your eyes off the world. Get your eyes off the circumstances. Don't let the fire go out. Don't let the fire go out, because as soon as the fire dies, here comes the enemy. As soon as the fire dies, here comes the wild animals. Look, they're there. It's not that they never was there. The fire kept them at bay. The fire kept him out of the camp. That fire will keep him out of your house, out of your home, out of your life. It'll keep him away from your children. The fire of God.
Thank you, Lord.
Don't take it for granted. Parents, fathers, mothers, come on, take a hold of your household. I just figured, you know, when the kids were growing up, and I've said this, and you're all tired of it by now, but how many nights have I walked the hallway down to their rooms when they were messed up and going the wrong direction, and I as a dad just wanted to unscrew their heads, and you know, and he's like, Lord Jesus, what are they doing? But you know what, it's those night hours fanning the flame, when I would have tears in my eyes, walk down the hall of the house and slide into that bedroom, and I find old Andrew or one of the boys snoring. He doesn't know, but I'm putting fuel on the fire. I'm taking oil and I'm rubbing it all over his head. He doesn't even know he's sleeping. I'm getting over to his feet. I'm rubbing his feet. I'm praying over the bed. You know, the doorpost. I'm rubbing in there. What am I doing? Put the fire on the inside. see the glaring eyes of the lions and the wolves and the hyenas. Ah, and they're coming, they're laughing at you. In a minute now, they'll pounce on you. What are you going to do? Stir up a fire in your life. Begin to worship. Begin to praise Him. In your house. Somebody walked one day with a sign, big old sign, in a New York busy street. I saw the picture one time. Dad preached about it. Had a big sign. I think the sign in the front says, "I'm a fool for Jesus." And people's laughing at him. He's a fool for Jesus. Well, the man turned, and the sign on the back said, "Whose fool are you?" Whoa. I don't think I will, you know, I don't want to get too radical. Your fire's going out. Your fire's going out. I don't feel, you know, once in a while coming to church, you know, that ought to be enough. Your fire's going out. Well, you know, just every so often I'll give them the offering. And maybe if they see, you know, and then, boy, it's all you, isn't it? That's the problem. It's too much of you. Too little of Him. That's why John said, "I must decrease. I must empty myself. Let Him fill my life. Let me walk, talk, eat, sleep, Jesus, 24 hours a day. Doesn't matter where I go. Jesus in the morning, Jesus at night. No sweeter name," the song said, "than the name of Jesus. No sweeter name than the name of Jesus." Hallelujah. Fan the flame. Fan the flame. How's your fire? The fire of God in your life, how is that? How would you rate that from 1 to 10? Where would that be? If you saw it in the middle, well, I'm doing pretty good. I'm about a 6.5. I'm at about a 5. You look warm. It's going out. It's going out. It's going out. I don't even have to ask, well, the ones that says, well, you know what? It's really out. It's 1 or 2. You know where you're at. God wants you full flame. The brighter the fire, the further the enemy. The lion will not cross and jump over that fire. I can guarantee you that. They stay. Jesus. As soon as the fire dies out, as soon as we get complacent, the sooner, I mean, you can tell in your heart. There have been days and times in my life, too many to mention, that I know that I was not right with God. I know I was carnal. I know I was not walking. Yeah, I could tell you I'm a Christian. Are you a Christian? Yeah. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, but I knew in my heart I'm not where I'm supposed to be. The fire's going out, friend. And what are you doing? You're allowing, you inviting the enemy. Who's the guy that said, "Make my day"? Clint Eastwood. Tell the young people what that is. They're going to wonder all afterward. What did he do? What? Somebody shout fire. It takes the fire of God, friend. It takes the fire of God to whip the devil. Religion can't do it. If religion could do it, the high priest and all the Levites, they would have done it. But it takes the fire of God in somebody's life. It takes the Holy Ghost full of burning in your heart that you can look at the sick and say, "Rise up in the name of Jesus." You could look at demons and devils and they got to run. Hey, come on. This is still a church that believes in the power of God. We still believe that God is real. The devil's defeated. We don't have to go for his lies. So what do I have to do, preacher? Well, I got to do to get my fire started. Well, responsibility is on you and I as priesthood, as the people of God. Because Paul said you're a holy priesthood. You're a holy nation, a royal priesthood. That's what he said. That's who you are. So we have responsibility. This morning, we can get that fire started right here. We can get a new fire started in your heart. I notice in that chapter, the three previous parts of it, he says, God said to the priest, he says, "Now tell the priest that's taking care of the fire," said, "every morning they got to take out the ashes. They got to clean out the place. Get the ashes out." They actually had to change garments. I mean, they had to get the garments on and work on the altar, and then they got to get the ashes out and have different garments going on. How many know there's got to be some garment changing going on in our lives? There's got to be some cleansing going on in our lives. You can't start a fire with a bunch of ash. Come on, you people have built fires before in the fireplace when it's loaded down with a bunch of ash of 3 years worth of stuff. I'm going to know it's hard to start a fire that way. Is it the truth? It's the truth. So what do you got to do? You got to clean the thing out. Andrew, we were at your house in Portland. That was the biggest mess I've ever seen. You stuck something up in that old house. How old is that house there now that you're trying to... It was built in the 1900s. I wonder, they are never from the 1900s. I mean, way back. 1900 wasn't that far back either. It was just like 16 years ago, actually. But this, I'm talking about way back. And he's trying to clean out that mess and remodel and whatever. Well, we stuck something up in that chimney, and here it came. I mean, heaps and bucket loads of the stuff. I don't see how these people made fire in that place. It couldn't go anywhere. It was clogged up with ashes of how many of them, we got some ashes in our lives and it's cleaning up. There's some leftover stuff from the past. You got to get that out. You got to, Holy Spirit, sweep it out of my life. The sweeping, beloved, I believe, is when you make that decision and the altars are open and you say, Lord Jesus, whatever's in my life, clean me up, Lord. He said, don't stop the fire. Don't build a new one with the old ashes still there. Get it cleaned out. And he says, take it outside of the camp. Read it, man. He says, take it outside of the camp. In other words, don't even bring it close to the house anymore. Don't even bring it close to where you are anymore. You're the temple of God. Don't even, if it's gone, it's gone. Go bury it somewhere. Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. He's speaking to somebody right now. You've been holding on to ashes.
Jesus.
Of the past.
Jesus.
And you wonder, Lord, where's the fire? I'm trying. How many have said that? I've said that to the Lord. I'm trying. I'm trying to sense you. I'm trying this and I'm trying that. And I'm over here. I'm singing a song. What more? Clean out the ashes. Clean out the fireplace. It's messy, isn't it? It's a messy job. Get your hands all dirty. But if you want fire, you gotta clean it, you gotta do the work. There's a preacher of the gospel back there, Brother Bob. Would you agree with me, sir? I know he's preached the same thing for many, many years. Without holiness, no man's gonna see God, friend. We could have us a whole church with, I don't know what kind of building would God give us, but if there's no holiness preaching, if there's no fire in the camp, I want no part of it. I want God's fire.
Yes.
You want God's fire? Clean up the house. Clean up the fireplace. And the Holy Spirit is speaking to you right now. I know that. He's knocking on your heart's door. He's pointing out what he's doing, Andrew. I'm just thinking of that. Thank you for, you know, how would you think a stick would come in handy today? But you grabbed a stick and he shoved it up that thing. And boy, it released something. Holy Spirit, would you take a stick today? Would you take a shepherd's stick and just put out all that mess in our lives? Would you allow him to do that?